thank you for the introduction and thank you all for being here today. I'm very excited and very thankful for the opportunity to present today here my work and the things that we're trying to do at the School of Forestry and the Forest Product Development Center. So the title of my talk, I decided to write it in a way that rethinking the use of trees, and I will talk about the advanced material from nanocellulose, and I will try to tell you and explain you what this means and what we are trying to work with. So we know, we all know trees, right? And we use them from many, many years in very traditional ways. We've been using wood to communicate our thoughts and our culture in the forms of papyrus, like many, many centuries ago. We've been using wood to have our housing. We have used our trees to use to make ships, to transport ourselves, to make fuel, to transport from point A to point B. So I have like some pictures here, very old houses. This house in Switzerland is like back from back in the 1100s, and it's still standing there. So we know that wood is not going to let us down. So we trust trees for many different purposes. So that use of trees in a way is in the concept of the bioeconomy. So many years ago we were already transitioning our economy based on bio-based materials, right? So we went through a lapse of many materials that we are using today based on non-renewable fuels. And we need to really think and considering back to transition to the bio-based economy. So the driver for this is like our population is growing very much, so our natural resources are declining as well. We are losing biodiversity, and we also have an impact in the climate. We are like transitioning climate change. So this is gonna give us like a lot of troubles very soon. We are facing, as you all know, by 2030, we are gonna have like a shortage in energy, in food, and also in water resources. So this is a very alarming thoughts. So we really need to start thinking on going back on the bio-based economy as such. And I think that in this community, we all know, and we're trying to work towards that in a multidisciplinary way. So what bioeconomy includes is the use of renewable bio-based natural resources in a very smart way, in a very sustainable way. We really need to use clean technologies to process them, that they are like environmentally friendly. And we also need to think about what are we gonna do with our materials and the life cycle of these, and how are we gonna recycle them, and how are we gonna reuse them. So towards this, what we are trying to do at the School of Forestry, together with many other departments of the school, and in a multidisciplinary adventure, as I try to think of, is to use trees in a different ways and try to make advanced materials out of it. So if we look, what do we have in biomass, and how can we like take advantage of biomass to make different materials? So all kind of biomass is gonna be like the same in a way. So we have trees and we have like different crops, and all these plants have the same structure, if you wanna think about it. So we have the plant cell wall that is composed of three main polymers, that they are like cellulose, that is just glucose units bind together in a certain way, that they are embedded in a matrix of hemicelluloses, and they are glued together with lignin. So these three biopolymers are the base from all kind of biomass in Earth, and I am gonna talk about cellulose today, which is the more abundant one of those three polymers. So cellulose is in the molecular level, if we think about the hierarchical way of wood, I don't know if this is working or not, doesn't matter. If we think about the hierarchical way that wood is put together, cellulose is a structural polymer, and it's like aligned, all these molecules are aligned in a certain way, packed very well in more or less crystalline forms, and they are like being constructed in a way that they are embedded in these other polymers and forming these trees that we know that they can withstand many adverse conditions in environment and even in fires and different conditions that we can think of. So this cellulose is like very interesting in the point of view of material science because we can use them for a lot of many other applications than the one we use today as paper mainly. So in the scale of things, we are thinking that, like I'm going to talk about nanocellulose today. So we want to go down from the big structure of tree. We want to go down to the nanocellulose. And we are thinking when we talk about cellulose fibers to make paper, we are talking about cellulose fibers that they are about 200 microns in diameters. And we want to go down to the nanoscale. This will allow us to use less material, less space if we want, and we will have like completely different properties, new phenomena that will allow us the production or the manufacture of advanced materials based on cellulose. So we want to deconstruct these fibers from the trees in a different ways, and then the different two ways of doing it is like we can do acid hydrolysis from them, and then we will end up with only the more crystalline form of cellulose, which are, we call cellulose nanocrystals, and they are these like rod-like particles, or we can do mechanical fibrillation of these fibers further than what we do to make paper, and we end up with nanofibrillate cellulose. So these two types of cellulose nanoparticles have like very distinctive properties and they behave differently. I like you to think about in terms of aspect ratio. Nanocrystalline cellulose, they behave like a plate of bowl, or like a bowl of rice, while nanofibrillated cellulose are these long fiber and like interconnected to each other, forming these like bowl of spaghetti. So the properties of these materials will be completely different, as I said. While the nanocrystalline cellulose, they have a very well-defined rheology. They can form liquid crystals, so we can use them in advanced properties, like, for example, OLED displays and that kind of materials where we need optical properties, distinctive from other polymers, other type of polymers. Nanofibrillated cellulose forms a very strong gel that can that is like a shear thinning, and it can stabilize other kind of nanoparticles, giving an opportunity to like be used in many other fields. So nanocellulose, of course, is biocompatible, biodegradable, and it has like a very high surface area. And it also has excellent mechanical properties as well. So it also has abundant free hydroxyl groups on the surface that we can use as a template for chemical modifications. So now we can use cellulose for the traditional uses, but we can also use this nanocellulose to advance in material science in many other fields that we haven't been thinking of before. So we can really add value to our forests, we can add value to our materials, and we can really make the difference is like in other areas that we haven't been working before. So very briefly, I would like to mention what kind of activities we are developing at the Forest Product Development Center at the School of Forestry and Wildlife Sciences, together with some other departments on campus. So one of the main projects we are looking at is the use of cellulose that has been that it still contains hemicellulose and lignin. So we are trying to see the different composition of the nanocellulose, how this will impact the final application. So instead of making the nanocellulose and finding the application later, we will look at the application and we'll see what kind of properties we want. We can leave the lignin there, we can make it more hydrophobic, we can leave the hemicellulose, we can make it more flexible as well. So the second project that we have is actually this idea comes from the last faculty symposium. This is research at Auburn because I heard a talk from fisheries and environmental science where they have an issue with cyanotoxins in water in the fish ponds. And then we were like, okay, maybe we can do something about it. We can modify our nanocellulose and our nanofibers to pick up those cyanotoxins. So we've been working with them, and we have an excellent synergy to like continue the project. So we have one other student working with electrospun nonwovens. So Simone is isolating silk fibrin from silk waste production, and we are reinforcing those with nanocellulose. And with electrospinning, we are making nonwovens that can be used in biomedical applications for example, tissue engineering, cell culturing, and that kind of application. So this is a project that we have with an agreement together with the USDA through the Forest Service. and Auburn University. And the last but not the least one, we are using nanocellulose to strengthen OSBs, or oriented strand boards, that is the project of the director of the center at the Forest Product Development Center with Dr. Baia. And he's, we are using this nanocellulose not only to improve the strength of the boards, but also to decrease the water susceptibility in like wet environments when we have, like, for example, soy flour in our boards. So we have like, we're really transitioning to like bio, like real bio-based boards, trying to get rid of all the nasty chemicals and nasty resins that they are currently used in the board industry. So that's basically what I wanted to share with you. Of course, this is not the only the work of myself. The group is amazing. The group in our department is like really remarkable. We are working together with chemical engineering, biosystem engineering, fisheries and environmental science as well, forest services, other collaborators across, like outside the university as well, in other countries. We are working with Colombia very actively. And really, like, I am very excited to be here. I'm very excited to hear all your thoughts about this. It's like an opportunity we have with nanocellulose to interact with many other disciplines. And thank you so much for your attention.